Everything we've discussed so far involved recognizing and tagging or engulfing shady things that were found outside of cells. So outside of cells, we've seen things like a B cell. A B cell has its membrane-bound antibodies. It's membrane-bound antibodies. Maybe one of these might recognize something shady out in the outside of the cell. And of course, this part over here, as we know, they all have a variable portion right over here. So this is specific to this shady thing. Then this will be engulfed. And then parts of it will be attached to an MHC II complex. So let me do that in a different color. So an MHC II complex, and then that will go to the surface, that will go to the membrane of the cell to present itself. So that's an MHC II complex. And so it has a little bit of the little piece of this shady thing out here. And we call this little shady piece. This is an antigen. This is an antigen presenting cell here. And then we've seen, especially if this is a B cell, then a helper T cell that is also has a variable portion that corresponds to this specific antigen. So this would be a helper T cell right over here. So this is a helper cell. When it recognizes, then it'll start dividing into memory helper T cells and effector helper T cells. And the effector helper T cells essentially ring the alarm bells and start kind of accelerating the B cell replication, or I guess you could say the B cell activation. And the theory is that this is kind of a double handshake process. But once again, this is what's occurring outside of cells. So when we found stuff outside of cells, we engulfed them and then we presented them on MHC II complexes. MHC II complexes. So now you're probably thinking, well, yeah, I mean, that's the outside of cells, but you know, there's MHC II, there's these helper T cells. But we've also referred to cytotoxic T cells. What do those do? And we've also, if there's MHC II, there's probably an MHC I complex. What does the MHC I complex do? And if we're, you know, we can recognize shady things that are happening outside of cells, but don't shady things sometimes happen inside cells? And how does our immune system respond to that? And actually, as you could imagine, all of those things will be answered in the rest of this video. So let's think about what's happening. Let's think about what happens when shady things start to happen inside a cell. So for example, it might not even be due to a virus or due to some type of bacteria. It could be the cell itself has gone awry. So let's say that this right over here is a cancer cell. So it's had some mutations, it's starting to multiply like crazy. So this is a cancer cell. And the cancer cell, because it's had this mutation, is going to produce some weird proteins. So these cancer cells are going to produce some weird proteins. So every cell with a nucleus in your body, and that's pretty much every cell except for red blood cells, has MHC I complexes. And the whole point of the MHC I complex is to bind to shady things that are produced inside of the cell. Shady things that are produced inside of the cell, and then present them to the membrane. So even a malfunctioning cancer cell should be doing this. So then it will. So this MHC I complex is bound to these strange proteins that are produced by the mutations inside of the nucleus, and then it can present them. And so what you could imagine what the appropriate immune response should be. These cancerous cells should be killed. And actually, let me label this properly. So that was MHC II. You're presenting an antigen that was initially found outside of the cell, it was engulfed and then taken out. MHC I, it's binding to shady things inside the cell and then presenting it out. Now, this thing should be killed. Now, as you can imagine, what's going to kill it? Well, that's where the cytotoxic T cell comes into the picture. So the cytotoxic T cell is going to have So that's a receptor right there. It'll have a variable portion that's specific to this type of an antigen. And so it'll bind there. And then once it does that, it says, oh boy, there's just all this shady stuff here, these shady proteins that are being produced. This cell and all the other ones like it need to be killed. And so the cytotoxic T cell will begin to replicate. Once again, like other types of immune cells, it's going to replicate into the memory cells, just in case this type of thing shows up 10 years in the future, and also the effector cells. So this is memory, and also effector, and also effector cells. Effector cytotoxic T cells. And as we always know, the effector version is the thing that actually does something. It starts to actually affect things. And what it is going to affect, it is going to start binding to things that are presenting the same antigen on top of their MHC I complex. So this character right over here. So it's presenting that same antigen. It's presenting that same antigen on this MHC I complex. And remember, the variable portions need to match up. So let's say that this is an effector cytotoxic T cell. An effector cytotoxic T cell. And actually, let me draw it a little bit different. So let me draw it like this. This is effector cytotoxic T cell. Its receptor, its variable portion, is the one that's compatible with this antigen that's being presented right over here. So let me just label this again. This is the MHC1 complex. This is an effector cytotoxic T cell. So we'll put the C there for cytotoxic. And what it does is it essentially kind of latches on to the cell that needs to die. And it does it, not only does it have this receptor interfacing with the MHC1 complex, but it actually has a whole series of proteins. And I'm not drawing this to scale, really. This would be much smaller relative to the scale of the cell that essentially latches on between the two. And I'm not going to go into detail, but essentially forms what you could call an immunosynapse, which is kind of where the two things are interacting with each other. And so when it identifies this and says, OK, I need to kill this thing, or essentially I need to make this thing kill itself, it starts releasing all of these molecules. So it can release molecules like perforins. So it'll release these perforins, which will essentially cause gaps or holes to form in the membrane of the cell that needs to die. And then it can release other things like granzymes that can go in and essentially cause this thing to kill itself. So the whole point of this video is to appreciate, I guess, what we haven't talked about yet. We had already talked about what happens when you identify shady things outside of the cells, and then how you can kind of bring them in and then present them, and then use that to kind of further activate the immune response. Now we're talking about identifying shady things inside the cells. Those get presented by MHC1 complexes, and then the cytotoxic T cells recognize them and then force the cell to kill themselves. And this wouldn't just be cancer cells. This could also apply to a cell that has already been infected by a virus. So for example, a cell like this, already, so that's its nucleus, it's already been infected by some virus. It's already been infected by some virus, so the virus has hijacked the cell's replication machinery in order to replicate itself. And so the proper immune response is, hey, look, I'm a virus-making machine. I should kill myself. So it'll take some of the antigens that are being produced inside of, by the viruses, they're going to bind to MHC1 complexes. So pieces of the virus are going to bind to MHC1 complexes, and then they're going to be presented on the surface. They're going to be presented, let me do it this way, presented on the surface. So this exact process can happen again.